Every aspect of our lives is permeated by decisions that we are constantly making. Be it a small decision, such as taking an umbrella with you, or big decisions, like choosing a house to buy, they all share the features that make decisions hard. And once it gets to a scale where we can affect not only our own lives, but the lives of many through a system-wide perspective, things can get quite overwhelming very quickly. First, there's this notion of complexity. So typically our decisions, they are tangled with many moving parts, which even though we have a good grasp of what's happening locally in terms of our decisions, sometimes it's really hard to grasp what's happening at a wider system level and their cascading effects. On top of that, there is this notion of uncertainty. One of the main reasons why we hesitate so much in making decisions sometimes is that we simply cannot know how the future will unfold. And when you combine these two things, at the end of the day, what we're trying to look for is consequences. How our decisions affect the system that we're looking at, and what are the consequences to it? Once we can understand how the parts move together, and we have a good description of how the uncertainty might unveil, we can then provide means to compare our alternatives and hopefully make a choice of what would be the best decision. So my name is Fabricio Oliveira. I'm a professor of operations research here at Aalto University. And today I'm going to talk a little bit about my research, which is on how we can use mathematics to quantify how complex systems behave under uncertainty and hopefully make better decisions. So bringing science to decision making is really the main motto of my research field, which is called operations research. Operation research basically concerns using analytical reasoning to quantify consequences and compare alternatives, such that we can then choose what would be a best course of action. So it's very much like many other fields of science, in the sense that we perform experiments under controlled conditions, and then we observe the results, and from those, we reason about hypotheses. The main difference, perhaps, is that we cannot use test tubes and laboratories, really. There is no such thing as trial and error when you're talking about real-life systems. This would be akin to repeatedly building and destroying depots at different places to try to decide which network configuration is the best, which I hope you realize it's absolutely nonsense. That's why we must rely on what we call models. But differently from traditional models made of cardboard and styrofoam, we build our models with mathematical equations. These equations are meant to represent relationships between the parts of the system and our decisions, and what are the logical implications that our decisions might have. Once we do that, this can be coded to a computer to form a digital twin, with which then we can perform all the experiments we like. And now is where things get really cool, because these digital twins, they are essentially mathematical equations. And because of so, we can use mathematical techniques that can shift the system towards optimal configurations. This is a discipline from applied mathematics that is called mathematical optimization. And basically what it is about is to understand function properties and try to find points that have very particular characteristics because they attain minimum or maximum values for that function within a region or within the function domain. Let me try to make what I mean a bit more clear. The thing is, once we know what are these properties, then we can state the conditions that any given point have tested satisfy, such that that point is a point of maximum or minimum value, or our optimal point, as we call. And then we can use that to design algorithms that go and search for that point. This is exemplified in that animation there. So what you're seeing is a function, which is represented by these beautiful arrow curves, which kind of acts like a map. So you see where the high color, the light colors are, you're seeing the high altitudes or the high values, and the dark colors, they are representing the lower values. And what our algorithm is doing there is trying to find a point of minimum value within the constraints of that blue box. And that is exactly what is behind an optimization method. This is, by the way, something that is called projected gradient, which is just one of many algorithms that can be used for that. I reckon that at this point you're asking yourselves, and what does that have to do with optimal decision making? Well, in a nutshell, that is exactly the question our research is trying to provide answers to. Let me show you how does that develop. It so turns out that there is a really powerful analogy that connects decision making and mathematical optimization. You can think of your function and the coordinates in that is represented there as what would be your decisions, which there we're representing as this X. In the drawing we had before, I only had two because I wanted something that you could see, but you could have hundreds or maybe thousands of those, which is not a problem for mathematics at all. And each of these dimensions, they would represent a decision, say the amount of production you have at a given plant, could be the capacity that is allocated to a production system being designed, or they could be perhaps the amount of products you're sending from point A to point B, exactly your decisions. And then you have a function, which I'm calling here F0, which is measuring the quality of that solution, which could be, for example, the total cost of the system or a service level that you're willing to maximize. And finally, our search region is basically are represented by all of those other functions that are representing the logical relationships between your decisions and the actual rules that you have to, you know, attend to when you are choosing feasible solutions. Could be, for example, safety requirements or physical limitations that have to be imposed. And once you have your problem stated like that, you can then use an algorithm just like the one before to find what is an optimal decision. This analogy, really, is what it is, mathematical programming is, which is the main branch in operations research that we do research in. So it's really a language to translate problems as mathematical models to which we can use an optimization method to then find an optimal decision for our regional system. And you might be thinking now, this actually has unlimited potential for what can be modeled. And yes, that is true. I brought here today a few examples from domains that I have been working with my collaborators, in which we used math programming to understand how we can make, or sometimes, what does it mean to make optimal decisions. The first of them is related to the context of supply chain management and production planning, which is kind of my background. In that, we are using these models to investigate how can we optimize, say, locations or size, perhaps routes, of inventory and distribution systems. And in this case, we are basically looking for efficiency in terms of costs and minimizing them, and service levels. Another really cool application is to management of blood units, so which is an inventory system to some extent, but it's far, far more challenging because we have to take into account things such as perishability, donor-patient compatibility issues, the fact that you cannot yet manufacture blood artificially, and the sheer realization that lives are at stake here. Another interesting application is the design of resilient systems and plan the preparation for emergency response. It turns out that by optimizing the pre-allocation of emergency response supplies and equipment, we can strive for robust and efficient responses, mitigating impacts of natural and even man-made disasters. And finally, more recently, we've been looking into these models that we use to understand the impact of measures such as carbon taxes, infrastructure development, or even market designs that can be used to foster renewable and cleaner energy generation. So in this case, these models, they help us, they act as tools to help us what a future could look like such that these conditions are met, which then can be used to feed into the policy making that will hopefully lead to such change. Needless to say, these contributions, were only possible due to the brilliance and hard work of people I have had the privilege to meet in my career path, and to a large extent are responsible for me being here giving this installation talk. The contributions that stem from our group, they relate to the science behind mathematically optimal decision making. And in that sense, we look into two complementary points. We're looking on how to model these problems, incorporating uncertainty and robustness requirements, and also how to solve these problems. In terms of the modeling, we are searching for ways to incorporate uncertainty considerations in decision making. So to think a little bit about that, in the current paradigm, what we have is we start from the data, and from that, we have a prediction model, which can be, say, a statistical machine learning model, which gives us a prediction that is fed into an optimization model to then provide us with a solution. However, this is well known that these predictions naturally encode error. And it turns out that our model can somehow exploit this error in a really perverse way, leading to misleading decisions and unwanted consequences. This is an effect that is well known, and it has this doomsday evoking name called the optimizer's curse. So to fix that, we go back to the drawing board and think of a model that can somehow incorporate not only errors in your prediction, but also the idea that your decisions might impact how the predictions work, which is something called endogenous uncertainty. As you might imagine, the current paradigm doesn't allow you to have this sort of interaction because prediction and decisions, they are completely separated. And then by doing so, we really hope that we can lead to better decisions. The other part is how to solve these models. The main barrier is really computational requirements. Differently from machine learning, optimization algorithms, they do not allow for parallelization naturally. So you cannot simply just throw computers at them and hope they will be solved faster. For that, we need to develop algorithms that can really exploit distributed computers in clusters like Triton, there in the picture. By the way, Triton is a brilliant infrastructure that is available for us here at Aalto and has played a fundamental role in our research, together with the Aalto Scientific Computing Initiative. I conclude my talk with this quote from Richard Bellman, who is a seminal reference in operations research, and whose work today serves as a foundation not for our field, but also for many fields out there, including, for example, reinforcement learning. These are really exciting times in terms of technological development that has, and also methodological development, that has opened doors to ever more sophisticated analytical models. But we must keep in mind that the purpose of it all, it stems from the search for ways to improve our understanding on how to make better decisions and ultimately improve these systems that play crucial roles in our lives. Thank you.